Jesus. Thank you for such a sweet and beautiful atmosphere. Thank you, Father, for your presence in this room this morning. We just pray, let the entrance of your word bring life, bring light, and let it bring understanding. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's appreciate Court and the band. I'm really, really actually very encouraged this morning. Just like Pastor was saying, from the words, even to the offering, the atmosphere has just been so encouraging for me. I feel that every word that's come forth from this stage today has actually preached this message. I believed it has stirred up the room. I believe that the presence of the Lord is as fully saturated this environment and this atmosphere and created an atmosphere for the word that you're about to receive. So I just really strongly feel the presence of the Lord in this place today. And I pray that the Lord will open our heart. And within this time that I have, that I will be able to bring to you something that will transform your relationship and your life in Jesus' name. So last week I spoke about understanding differences in a relationship. I was able to delve into the meaning of understanding that it involves interpreting information, it involves recognizing pattern, and it even involves making sense of someone's attributes, behavioral patterns. And I broke that down into different areas of understanding. I said perspectives, background principles. I talked about understanding preferences, understanding patterns, understanding roles in a relationship, understanding perception. Well, that's how we think. But one of the things that I remember that I said to you clearly was that understanding differences in a relationship is crucial for growth and maturity. And I really strongly felt that at that point when I was writing down that statement, that the Lord said to me that it's time for us to grow and mature. I don't know if you remember, I said to you, say to somebody, grow up. So we're going to do that again. So say to somebody, grow up. It's really a season, and I can really sense that it's an atmosphere of growth and maturity. And you wouldn't really understand what that word meant, because the things that I know today, if I had known them before, I think it would be a different story now. But I thank God I have a beautiful marriage. I'm married to a wonderful man, and I'm grateful to God for our growth and our maturity and our progress. I think throughout this year, every day has been like a recognizing the growth and the changes that we've made. And we look at each other and we're proud of each other for how far we've come. Yeah. Thank you for being there and standing with me all this while. And I'm going to pour from my heart to you from my journey. And I hope that for those who are just preparing, or those who are about to go into a relationship, or those who are just recently married, especially I have a heart for those very young marriages, that those young stages of your married life will be beautiful in Jesus' name. So today, yes, I'm definitely talking about growing and maturing in relationships. And I'm going to just try and stay with my notes, so help me God, so that I can finish them. I have a very huge content today. I stayed up all night typing it up. Just in case, so I don't miss out anything. So the first scriptures I'm basing this on is Proverbs 23:24, 3-6. And I'll be reading that from the NIV version, which says, by wisdom a house is built, and through understanding it is established. Through knowledge its rooms are filled with rare and beautiful treasures. The wise prevail through great power, and those who have knowledge muster their strength. Surely you need guidance to wage war, and victory is won through many advices. Talking about the importance, the power of wisdom, understanding, and knowledge to build. And those are the key ingredients if you must grow and mature in relationship. Maturity is the ability to think, speak, and act within bounds of dignity. The measure of your maturity is how spiritual you become in the midst of frustration. So when situation is tense, when you are meant to react in a certain way that the world will expect you to, maturity, you can measure your maturity by the way you think at that point, by the way you speak, by the way you act, and by the way you respond. Now, what do I mean? Come, just follow me. Growth and maturity in relationship is pivotal to building a great and meaningful relationship. So if you're going to build a meaningful relationship, you require growth and maturity. I believe this season, like I said earlier, is a season of growth in our relationship, and I want you to pay attention to that. And this is not just because you're married. This is any relationship that you're trying to manage, even those relationships that is a thorn in your flesh. And I really trust God that there's going to be so much growth across this room after today's sermon in Jesus' name. Maturity and growth is attained when wisdom is applied. Now, this is my definition, so you won't find it anywhere. And I'm so proud to own it. Maturity and growth is attained when wisdom is applied with knowledge gained through understanding. You must constantly build with wisdom, establish with understanding, and occupy with knowledge to attain maturity and growth in a relationship. So all I've just done is a play of words on Proverbs 24:3. I don't have time to go through it. I would have expanded on that definition, but I have to move on. Now let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And I really wanted to read the whole of the chapter, but I will probably just pick through. In fact, I intended that I will ask different people to read from the congregation. So talking about growth and maturity in relationship, was established that by wisdom a house is built. By understanding it is established. And through knowledge its rooms are filled with rare and beautiful things. But when we go to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, it tells us really who is a mature person and who is an immature person. So I'm going to read some parts of it and I'll skip through just so we can gather the context of that passage. Brothers and sisters, I could not address you as people who live by the Spirit, but as people who are still worldly. Mere infants in Christ. Wow. To the Corinthian church. I gave you milk, not solid food, for you were not yet ready for it. Indeed, you are still not ready. What a state. You are still worldly, for since there is jealousy and quarreling among you, are you not worldly? And this is a question we can ask ourselves as a church. Sometimes when we read the scriptures, it's so far away and you think it only exists in those days. But whilst reading this, it could just resonate with me. And I felt as if the Lord was showing me the state of the church. Are you not acting like men, humans? For when one says, I follow Paul, and another, I follow Apollos, are you not mere human beings? I'm going to move to verse 10. By the grace God has given me, I laid a foundation as a wise builder. Going back, linking it back to by wisdom. A house is built, and someone else is building on it. But each one should build with care. For no one can lay any foundation other than the one already laid, which is Jesus Christ. If anyone builds on this foundation using gold, silver, costly stones, wood, hay, or straw, their work will be shown for what it is, because the day will bring it to light. It will be revealed with fire, and the fire will test the quality of each person's work. So we need to grow up because our work in our relationship will be tested. And for those who are married already, or even any relationship, you know that every relationship goes through test and fire that will prove whether it can stand or whether it's going to break you. Verse 16, don't you know that you yourself are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. For God's temple is sacred and you together have that temple. Do not deceive yourself. If any of you think you're wise by the standard of this age, you should become fools so that you may be wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness in God's sight. As it is written, it catches the wise in their craftiness. I'm going to stop there. There's so much gems in that whole 1 Corinthians chapter 3. But I'm going to stop there because I think it's given a good foundation for my message today. Let me quickly ask you, before I start talking about maturing and immature, can you identify immaturity in relationships? I think a verse in particular already told us about what immaturity looks like. And I'll say it because I don't want you to say the answer so you can think outside of the box. Verse 3 said, you're still worldly, for there is jealousy and quarreling among you. In an environment where there is quarreling and jealousy is a sign of immaturity. So can I have a roaming mic? Can I have people shout out at me? What are the signs of immaturity? Because if we can identify immaturity in a relationship, then you know that you've got some work to do. I have got loads here I'm going to read to you, but I just want to hear from the church. Let's engage, let's talk.
Easily angered.
Thank you so much. In fact, that's the first point I have. Offense or temper and overreacting, triggered by every little comment, is a sign that you need to grow up. Darren.
Holding grudges.
You guys are so good. Holding grudges. I've written here that anger or silent treatment that goes on for days. My husband is laughing because I used to be there. My silent treatment goes on for days. Looking back now, I knew I was very mature. You think it's a skill. You think it's a weapon. No, it's immaturity. Sorry to... If you carry on, you're just playing. You're just a baby. Remember what Paul said? I gave you milk, and you're still acting worldly. So a baby that is meant to grow out of milk at 6 months is still drinking milk and not taking solid. The wonder should be worried. If at 12, they're not 12 months, they're not taking solid, they're still drinking milk, there's trouble. It's the joy.
Unforgiveness.
Thank you. Wow. That's a big part of my note today. I don't know if I'll get there, but thank you. Unforgiveness. I'll just read my note, but those are powerful things. I also put here lack of patience and making wrong choices. When you're impatient, you will make error. Error of judgment in relationship, resulting to loss, debt, because you think your spouse is too slow, or maybe whatever relationship you are, you think they're not fast. You need to propose now. No, calm down. Be patient, because you can make mistakes. I forgot to say last week that so many people have missed valuable relationships, quality relationships that could have stayed because of the lack of patience. Now you are in another one and you are doing the same thing and you're probably about to lose this. Let me just sound a note of warning that you need to grow up. And also, sometimes if you're immature, you might miss the red flags and you find out as I go along. You might miss relationships that you need to exit, but you're still remaining in there. It's depending on your state of maturity. And you will see that when I go into spiritual maturity. So I've written a sense of entitlement or neediness, constantly playing the blame game. And that happens in any relationship. It's never your fault. You're never at fault. It's a sense of entitlement, which I'm going to break down later. If I get that. Using punishment and giving silent treatment is not the right way to behave. It's a sign of immaturity. Living an hypocritical life. And what do I mean by that? You come to church, you say, Lord, I love you. But yet the things you say to your fellow human beings are unpleasant. You talk about people. You speak to your spouses anyhow you like. And you're saying you love God. No, you're an hypocrite. And it's a sign of immaturity that you need to grow up. I'm going to move on quickly because I want to talk about two ways of developing growth and maturity in your relationship. And I want to talk about spiritual growth and maturity. how to develop spiritual growth and maturity. And I'm going to talk to you about how to develop emotional growth and maturity, which some people call in these days now emotional intelligence. Now, spiritual growth and maturity. This is maturing in spiritual encounter and growing in fellowship and intimacy with the Holy Spirit. You cannot grow in any situation. Oh, don't, why? Okay, I won't tell you what he said. I won't tell you. He's setting me up. Growing in spiritual maturity is a place of fellowship and intimacy with the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. I don't know, some people say, oh, I'm looking, waiting for the man to lead our family in a spiritual way, to lead the home. It sounds so right to say, right? It sounds like it's such a legitimate thing to say. Oh, I'm waiting for my husband. But what are you doing when you're waiting? Ladies, can I talk to you? Are you assuming your spiritual positioning in your household? Are you taking spiritual authority in your household? For moms, can your children see that you're a praying mom? Can your children see that my mom prays? And can your children see that my mom is a warrior and giant in the place of the Spirit? It's all well and good for you to use the very, very lovely language that I'm waiting for my husband to lead, and you're complaining for thy kingdom come, but you are responsible for your own spiritual life. That is what maturity plays on you. I think I missed that part of my note. Maturity places responsibility on your spiritual life. So let me talk to the single. So all you do and wait, you're waiting for the right man to arrive. I'm so glad that we've prayed to be found today. But when you're waiting, you have work to do. You have work to do to build on your spiritual stamina and spiritual strength, because you're going to need it when the going gets tough. You're going to need it for your life. Because in marriage, in any relationship, everyone is responsible for their own spiritual life. So I've said spiritual maturity is pivotal to attaining realms of wisdom, understanding, and knowledge required to build a purposeful relationship. So it was beautiful when we read that by wisdom a house is built, by understanding is established, and by knowledge his rooms are filled with beautiful treasures. But you need spiritual maturity in order to attain that realms of wisdom, that realms of understanding, and that realms of knowledge. Otherwise, it's just going to continue to stay at the surface. As I go on, you begin to see how I build the layers of spiritual growth and maturity. I've said the health and wealth of your relationship is going to be largely based on the temperature of your spiritual life. You know, a thermostat start. It has in every house has a thermostat that controls the heating system, and it has different levels. During summer we turn it down, during winter we turn it up. That's how a thermostat works, and it determines the temperature. The health of your home, the wealth of your home, is dependent, largely dependent and based on the temperature of your spiritual life. So if the temperature and the thermostat is very low, the wealth, you're toiling and playing with the wealth and the health of your relationship. Let me tell you, it's not even about the number of counselors and therapists you see. There are so many battles that will be resolved by you turning up the temperature of your spiritual life, and you save your money. But you can spend time with a counselor, but you can't spend time daily at the feet of Jesus. And we allow the enemy to attack our homes. We allow the enemy to attack our friendship groups. We allow the enemy to attack our lives. I have so many scriptures here, but I'm just going to call it for you. You can read it when you listen back to this message. 1 Corinthians 2, 10 to 11. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God.
You want to know the depth of God for your marriage, for your relationship, for your children. You need to have a relationship that takes you to that place that you experience the depth of God's wisdom, spiritual knowledge and understanding. I'm calling you higher today to step up your spiritual game. Stop playing around. It's enough. Stop drinking milk. It's time to attain levels of spiritual growth. It's time you need to, if you need to be in your, let your children be in church. Moms, you have meeting today. I'm not the one taking the meeting, so you are, God will save you. But moms, let your children grow up in church. I say to my girlfriend and we mothers, I said, I'm so afraid of this generation. I'm bringing up my children in church and sometimes I feel, Lord, am I doing enough? I wonder children that are not growing in church. I wonder what's going on. We are still able to take authority and tear down every imagination and stronghold, right? What if we don't have that? So I'm telling you, moms, you have no excuse. We've laid our hands on our husbands today. Do you lay hands on those children and speak life over them? You need to come up and step up your spiritual game. The Bible says, when the people slept, the enemy sowed tears. Wake up. Say to somebody, please wake up. I'm even begging you, wake up. Because we don't want the enemy to sow tears in our midst. Some of us have lost things because we're sleeping. But it's time to wake up, because I believe the Lord will restore, we will pursue, we will recover all, and we will overtake in Jesus' name. Oh. The way you treat and relate to people around you is an indication of your relationship with the Holy Spirit. I don't think you get that. The way you even treat people around you, the way you respond, last week I talked all about hot temper, low temper, and I'm not going there. Now I'm moving further. The reason why you are blowing hot and cold is because of your relationship with the Holy Spirit. You can tell someone who has been dining and whining with the Holy Spirit. And you will see that as we go on. So how do we attain spiritual growth and maturity? I'm going to go through that quickly. James 1, 3 to 4 talks about perfecting faith. Through the test of our faith, we produce perseverance. The situations that we go through in life helps us to build spiritual growth and maturity. We are being formed onto maturity through the various tests and trials and circumstances that surround us. They all strengthen and shape our character. So sometimes I used to think, you think people are saying things about you or people are doing things intentionally to hurt you and they're actually waiting for you to respond. But the more you fellowship, the more you build your place of spiritual intimacy with the Holy Spirit, the more you are able, your character is formed, your character is being shaped into an agent of change in your relationships. I'm just getting started. I'll move on to producing fruit of the Spirit. How do you attain spiritual growth and maturity? By producing fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5, 22, 23 talks about the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things, there is no law. The workings of the Holy Spirit in our lives produces growth manifested by bearing the fruit of the Spirit. So I said, firstly, perfecting faith, working with the Holy Spirit, perfecting your faith through your test, through your trials. Now the manifestation of that is that your character is being shaped in, and your character is being shaped up. You are manifesting the fruit of the Spirit. When somebody offends you, you are not on the wrong. But you find it so comfortable. You're not even thinking about, I'm on the wrong. You're not even thinking, but I'm right. No, you have grown to a level that you really don't care about being right anymore. And the fruit of forgiveness is then produced in you. and you are going and approaching them and saying, I'm sorry. You know, when you approach someone that is wrong and you're not the one that is wrong, the first thing you've done is you've broken the backbone of offense. There's no way offense can take root anymore. When the Holy Spirit, one of the dealings of the Holy Spirit with me was to bring me to a place whereby I forgive a step ahead. And it's a level of spiritual maturity you get to that offense is no longer something, a feeling that you experience. And it is possible. Because once you can break the backbone of offense in any relationship, I tell you that relationship will thrive. But if offense has a way to get its root down, you will need midnight prayers. Hallelujah challenge. to come back and uproot. Hallelujah. And uproot. To make sure that that marriage thrives again. Or that relationship thrives again. And when I'm talking about relationship, I'm cutting across all levels. The brother sitting next to you, the sister sitting next to you, your husband, your wife, your children, your work relationships. I'm cutting across all levels. And I've said, this is something my husband and I normally say, that the ultimate love language is the fruit of the Spirit. It's not act of service. It's not quality time. It's not touch. Those things, like I said last week, they come and go. Some people are multilingual. And it can get up and down every time. You can get it so wrong. But you know what you can get so right? Is the nature of the Holy Spirit being formed in you. The ultimate love language in relationship is the fruit of the Spirit. Love languages can fail, it can change, it can diversify, it can swing angles, but the fruit of the Spirit will stand the test of time and will always bring out the best in you and brings out the best in other people. You need to start producing the fruit of the Spirit. If all you know is love language, grow up. Your own language, you are confused about it. Don't you need the Holy Spirit to help you to dissect into the wisdom or the depth of the understanding of who you're dealing with? We're talking about maturing and developing growth in a relationship. It's enough that our relationships are tossed up and down. We don't enjoy good relationships. No. That's not God's heart for us. And I want us living here today, stepping out into any relationship and enjoying God's divine purpose and calling for you and in your relationships. In Jesus' name. Amen. So when you find it difficult, I've just put an example here, I'll probably skip it. When you find it difficult to live with understanding with people, it's an indicator that the fruit of Spirit needs to develop in you. I'll give you a quick example just to bring it down. I feel like I'm there. Let me bring it down a little bit. Fruit of patience was developed in me. And do you know how it was developed in me? I learned the fruit of patience by waiting for my husband to carry out DIY tasks in our home. Hallelujah. If I feel alone. It feels like there's no other one that waits. No. Am I alone by myself? No. Okay. All right. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. This is what we experienced this week. And our home is currently going through some beautiful. It didn't know why I was taking the picture. I told it was for something else. Going through some beautiful redecoration. But I must tell you that my daughter requested for this in December. And this is February and it's done. It's a record. Please celebrate my husband. It is a record. And you know what? That's not really where I'm going. No, that's not where I'm going. I'm building up. You know why I said that is? During those 3 months, I was not moved. I was not shaken. And I was controlling the thermostat, the temperature of my daughter's emotions.
encouraging and say, this will be done. And there's so much I'm trying to achieve here that the fruit of the Holy Spirit, relationship with the Holy Spirit, produces patience in you. And I have so much patience I don't believe I can have. But the Lord allowed me to build patience through little DIY tasks that I now apply to every area of our relationships. I am so patient for my husband's decision because I'm now excited that when he carries it out, it's going to be good. That's where I'm going. That's really where I'm going. Even if it takes him 1 year to change the smoke alarm. Babe, I just want you to know that I am patient with you. I am waiting on God with you because I know when it is done, you do an excellent job. It sounds like it is funny, but I'm telling you that it has built so much patience that I can't believe myself that I have. I don't moan. That's where I'm going. I don't complain. When I get to communication, which is, I'm probably going to tell you, which I'm going to probably say do next week. I thought this is over. Sleepless night. It's not easy. All week. Every day you are thinking about Sunday. Yeah, so I'll be rounding up shortly. When I get to communication, you will understand what I'm saying, that I'm not moody. Because before, that 3 months would have been hot pressure. Every day I'll be telling him, I don't understand how we can have you in this house. And the children are asking to paint the room. And we are still here. 1 week down the line, the room is not painted. And I'm moaning. That's really where I'm going. I'm telling you, I'm walking you through my journey of patience, how I've developed growth and maturity in the place of patience. And I'm not moaning. And on top of moaning, I could have probably added silent treatment. By the time I stop talking to you, you will know it's a serious matter. But you know what I do, babe? I tell the children, I know your dad is going to do it. You see, what patience does is, it's working out something in you and producing change in the other person. Because we're talking about what color should we have. I'm then talking to my daughter. Maybe it's nice that we have this time. We can use this time to decide and you're sure of what color. I said, you know, mom, that's it. You're right. You're beginning to take control of the atmosphere in your home. You're taking control of the territory in your home. The house is calm and nobody is upset with each other. That's what this fruit of the Spirit produces in you. I need to wrap up spiritual maturity because next week we'll go to emotional maturity where I'm really coming for everybody. And the fact that I'm going to have another week to ruminate and rest on it, you had better be in the room. Tell your neighbor you must be in the room. It's going to be hot and there'll be fire in this place. Holy Ghost fire. Hallelujah. So I'm going to finish up very well developing spiritual maturity. And the next way to develop spiritual maturity is stewardship in marriage or in any relationship. Building stewardship. This is an act that fosters unity and agreement in a relationship and creates an environment of safety and protection. I'll break that down to you because I'm sure it sounds so big, even me just reading it. Let me give examples of financial stewardship. When we got married the first year, I did not want to do joint account. It was my first ever job. And I went straight from uni. I came into UK, no work experience. And this is my first corporate job. And I'm excited about it. I got married the same year I started my first corporate job. So I didn't get the chance. I'm just explaining why, which I've been telling you. I didn't get the chance to enjoy my pay, my money. And first salary, joint account, say, no. We're not jointing. It's not going to work. But my husband believed in this principle. Remember I talked about principle, understanding people's principles last week. When you understand their principle, you require submission. When you submit to their principle, you see how submission will work in your favor. When I get to submission
built a hedge of protection around you. Submission is powerful. So after 1 year, the Holy Spirit convicted me. And I decided to do joint account. What happened on that year? I'm going to start breaking it down to you. It has never happened before, and I've never heard it until today. We bought our first house mortgage without any deposit. 100% mortgage. No deposit. Somebody walked to our house and gave us a car key. I've never heard of it. You get car gift. We were not pastors. We were just a worship leader. House group leader. That's all. But the kind of doors that opened up, my husband's salary right before my eyes jumped, doubled, right before my eyes. You know what I was doing? I was opening the door for the cracks to come in. It didn't matter whether his joint account he was asking for. It was an authority. He was operating from an authority that he had with Christ, because Christ is the head of the church. So my husband was positioned under Christ. So what authority he gives to me as the third person in Trinity, as the embodiment of the Paracletus. Ladies that have been in my sessions understand that. That authority protects me. And when I respond to him, he protects him, because he is then under authority and we are protected and we are covered. So your submission goes up. His covering goes up. And you build a hedge of protection around your home. Are you listening to me? And so when you're not listening and thinking it's my way or the highway, you are breaking the hedge. And you are allowing the doors to crack and the cockroach, lizard, snakes, worm to come and tabernacle. But when I took that act, there was a year my husband said, my salary just goes into the joint account. I get my full salary after tithe as my allowance. Please, how else do I want to enjoy life as a wife? In this England, I do not contribute to the home, because it takes care of it all. Up to today, my sister knows, it's such a shame. When they asked me, how much is the gas bill? I'll be crying. What is council tax? Council tax. I've not changed. Because that's the protection I get. That's the shield I get when I'm not submitted to a man that is under authority. And that's where I'm going to end it today. Can we rise on our feet? Because I want us to pray for spiritual altars to be restored in our homes, in our marriages today. If your spouse is here, hold on to them. If your friends are here, hold on to somebody. Just hold on to somebody, because we are praying and for restoration of our spiritual altars in the name of Jesus. Makatori kariba, sotori kariba, santaria. Makari kari, I didn't get the chance to talk about consistent study life. Go, families, you need to go back to the place of studying the word of God together. If you want to grow up spiritually, if you want the Lord to be the center of your home, if you want to make sure that your relationship is shielded and covered from cracks, you need to go back to the place of prayer and the praise of the word. Oh, can we raise our voices this afternoon? Come on, raise your voices as we cry for restoration of our prayer altars, for restoration of our commitment to the walking with the Holy Spirit. Restoration of broken down spiritual altars. I know few people came out early, but I'm not calling any altar call, but the Lord said to me right there that altars are broken down in this place. I heard it clearly, expressly. You are fighting battles every day in your marriage. Or you are fighting constantly. Every relationship you get into, you are breaking it because there's an argument. Number one is a sign that you are immature. Number two is a sign that your spiritual life is on the decline.
and you think you don't need restoration of your prayer life. Ah, pray for the person next to you. Pray for the person you're holding their hand. Pray that the Lord will restore every broken down spiritual altars. You are constantly arguing with your spouse and with people, and you're wondering why. And you don't pray together, and you're wondering why. Maybe you prayed on Watch Night Eve, and since then, that's the last time you've agreed as a family. And you're wondering why there is constant disagreement. You're wondering why you're making wrong decisions. You're wondering why things are not going the way they should. It is because altars are broken down. Ah, right, cry to God today that there will be restoration in this place today. There will be restoration today. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.